Hello everyone, you're listening to the Everything Geek podcast. I'm your host Ruari, and joining me today is a very special guest. We have Noah Benjamin, best known for playing Yuma Tsukumo in Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links, Alan in Storage and Chau in Crowdwork. How are you today?
I'm doing just fine, Ruari. How are you?
I'm very good, thank you. It's a pleasure to have you on the show today.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. This is great. I love talking to people. Any chance to get to talk to people?
Absolutely, that's fantastic. And of course, we're all about talking here on the podcast.
Well, that, yeah, as a podcast should be.
Absolutely, for sure. So, getting right into my questions for you, Noah, can you tell me, first of all, how you got into acting?
Well, it was a very, very long time ago. I was a kid who liked to dip his toe in a lot of different pools. I was an athlete for a while. I tried dancing for a while. I tried a bunch of different things for a while. Nothing really stuck until I found acting when I was like 12 or 13. Started on the stage with musicals, as many people do, in Fiddler on the Roof Jr., which was a very fun show, like a completely half-cut version of Fiddler on the Roof. So that's kind of where my passion for acting started, and it kind of blossomed from there when I've kind of figured out that I could actually, you know, this was a career choice rather than just a hobby.
Yeah, absolutely. That's fantastic. So can you tell me how you were originally cast as Yuma Tsukumo in Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links?
Yeah, sure. So I just recently graduated, class of 2020, the Conservatory of Theater Arts at Webster University in St. Louis, Missouri, USA. And at the end of the year, we did, at the end of our year in March, right before the pandemic hit, we had a New York showcase where we performed for casting directors and agents in New York City, and kind of for an open one for whoever wanted to show up. But literally 2 days after that showcase, the pandemic hit New York City. And Broadway closed its doors, and everything shut down. So it was also really hard to get a flight back home, but that's another thing. But when I did get a flight back home, we had one more showcase to go. We had an LA showcase, and we didn't know what to do, because LA was at that time, in May now, was kind of becoming a hotspot, and so we weren't going to take chances and go there, we being my senior class, 2020. So we decided to do a virtual showcase instead. We got to meet a bunch of people from all around. It's where I met the casting director, who kind of introduced me to the voiceover world. And from there, I met with him for a little bit, and I was like, hey, keep in touch. It was so much fun to work with you. I love voiceover. And he was like, actually, I think I'm gonna have you audition for something pretty soon here. I was like, oh, okay, yeah, absolutely. Send something my way. And this is kind of what he sent my way. And from there on, it was just hurry up and wait. You know, I would do an audition, and then I would wait for a while for a response, and then do the next round, and then just rinse and repeat until I got it. And that was a thrilling moment. Yeah, and it was a virtual moment, but it was a very thrilling virtual moment.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's just amazing that with like the showcases and the auditions, I mean, it's just so handy that you can still do those like virtually, like.
Right. Yeah. And the silver lining, like, I never probably would have met that person had I not, you know, I this probably never would have happened. And as horrible and as dark as this world is right now, finding silver linings is like the only thing we can do. And I was just, I'm so blessed and happy that this was mine.
Yeah, absolutely. Were you a fan of Yu-Gi-Oh! Or where of Yu-Gi-Oh!'s popularity prior to your casting?
Funny enough, when I was 6 years old, I dressed up as Yugi for Halloween from the original TV show. So yes, I was very aware of Yu-Gi-Oh!'s popularity. It was very popular with me in my household. I was growing up when it first kind of became a big thing, when that first TV show came out. You know, whenever I was sick or pretended to be sick to stay home from school, I would watch that, or I literally probably would just watch that, the TV show or the movie. And so Yu-Gi-Oh! Was a huge thing for me. when I was a kid. So the fact that this whole process has kind of come full circle for me at the beginning of my career at this scary time, it's been oddly comforting. And that's kind of that. I was aware of it, and still am super aware of it, and very happy that it's still popular, because I loved it when I was a kid, trading and dueling, even though I didn't really know what I was doing. I had the dual disc, you know. I had the original one, the plastic one that would cut your arm every time it came across, and...
Yeah, I know that all too well, but, like, that's amazing. Like, if there's any pictures of that Yugi cosplay, you should definitely put them online or something.
I have my old Yu-Gi-Oh cards right next to me, Yugi's Legendary Decks. For good luck now.
That's amazing. And I know it's probably a silly question to ask you, but of course some of the listeners won't be aware of your backstory and that you love Yu-Gi-Oh, but like one of your most recent Instagram posts was of course the classic Egyptian god cards.
Right, so... exactly. Those, oh my gosh, when I got those cards when I was a kid, I think that's like the second most excited I think I've ever been in my life. I don't know what the first most excited moment is, but that was definitely up there.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's fantastic. And so, of course, you mentioned that you're already a fan of Yu-Gi-Oh! Yourself and of the original series. Of course, like, in terms of ZEXAL, though, were you aware of the character of Yuma from the ZEXAL anime?
So I was aware of the show. I was aware of the anime, but I was not aware of the actual character. I hadn't watched the show. You know, Yu-Gi-Oh! was a thing that I had kind of grown out of, and much to my chagrin, as I'm now finding out, having rewatched and having kind of now done my research, it's grown so much. I mean, it has expanded in ways that I could not have possibly thought of when I was a kid. And if I had told myself back then that I would be doing this now and that I'd be voicing this character now, my 6-year-old self would probably pass out on the spot. Even though he hated nap time, he would probably pass out on the spot.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like, I mean, obviously it would have been, like, a dream for you to voice any, like, you know...
Right, exactly.
Yu-Gi-Oh, but to, like, be the new voice of one of the lead characters is just,
right,
like, incredible.
And to be a lead character who's young, you know, who's a youth, and who was, like, who's older, obviously, than I was when I was first into it, but I was still very much into it when I was... you know, Yuma's relative age, and so it was just really a treat to be able to dive back into a, like, nuanced look at my childhood that I really enjoyed.
Yeah, absolutely, that's brilliant. So did you rewatch any of the ZEXAL episodes before recording for Duel Links to help you get into the spirit of Yuma?
I did, yeah, and it was incredibly helpful, and they also sent me a ton of samples, and they sent me a full description before I auditioned, and I watched anything that I could get on Hulu with the amount of time that I had. It was kind of a quick turnaround, but, you know, I did as much as I could in the time that I had, and that's why I'm saying, like, it's expanded so much, you know, from watching, like, the Three Worlds episodes and the difference from the Yu-Gi-Oh! Of the past and the Yu-Gi-Oh! Now. It's just incredible, and I was happy that could even be my research. It just blew me away, and I was smiling the whole time.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Yu-Gi-Oh! Research is just one of the best kinds of research.
Absolutely. And like, what draws me to that show more than anything is I love the summoning animations of that show. They're so cool and beautiful and, like, rotoscoped and, like, artistic. It's a work of art. It's really cool.
Yeah, definitely. Now, of course, we have to talk about this next bit. A lot of Duel Links players and fans were surprised with the revelation with the ZEXAL World launch that Yuma had a new actor in yourself for Duel Links, and that the original actor, Eli James, didn't reprise the role. When you were cast for Duel Links, did you feel any added pressure or nervousness knowing you were taking on a role someone else had done before?
Oh, of course. And you know, anytime that happens, you know, I'm gonna be nervous. But it's the same in theater, you know, like, I've played the same role twice in theater before. Like, it's all about creating and making your version of that character And so I wasn't as nervous as much in that respect. Keep in mind, this also was my first, like, big time, like, my first gig, my really out of college, my first professional gig. So that was more nerve wracking for me than the replace. But I mean, Eli James did such a wonderful job creating the voice of this character that it was kind of easy to slip into the essence of this character because it was so clear from the moment I saw it. So props to him for that.
Yeah, absolutely. Eli did a fantastic job as Yuma, and you.
Yeah, everyone did. Yeah, everyone in that show did fantastic. I loved it.
Yeah, and you do a really good job as this new actor as well.
I appreciate it.
I know a number of people like didn't know as much of a difference, or were surprised when they even found out that like it was a different actor.
Well, that's good. That's what I was hoping for. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah, absolutely. So what kind of direction were you given when recording Yuma for Duel Links? Like, were you given any freedom to give your own take, or did they really want you to try and match Eli as much as possible?
You know, it was a very healthy mix. As an actor, you know, I always kind of want to be an artist, and I kind of want to shape the character in as many ways as I possibly can, you know, through my observation and through, you know, my methods or what you will. But they did want specifically for the voice to sound as much like that performance as possible, you know. But that being said, they also gave me, for lack of a better phrase, you know, free rein or liberty to kind of explore this character in my own voice, in my own way, and not just emulate the sound of the voice, but be that essence, you know, be that character in the moment. And that's basically what will get you through at the end of the day, is if you have the essence of the character and you know relatively what it sounds like, then it's really go from there at that point.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes a lot of sense, because of course, you know, taking on a role someone else had already done before is going to be tricky. Like, obviously you're going to be compared to the original performance. Like, I've interviewed a lot of people over the years, like some of them have had to take on roles other actors did before. Like, sometimes the direction they're given is like to try and match the other actor as much as possible. Sometimes they've been told, just do your own thing.
Right.
Like, not all the time are actors actually told to, like, you know, try and sound as much like the original actor as possible. Some people are told, you know, do your own thing with the character. So, like, it's really interesting to hear that there was a bit of a healthy mix in there. Like, wanted you to try and sound as much like Eli as possible, but also gave you freedom to give your take and put your stamp on the character a bit.
Yeah, you know, and there's no matter what, there's always going to be slight differences from revivals and from, you know, from the originals. It's going to be almost impossible. Some people can do it on a whim. For those people, I applaud. Jim Carrey, one of them, anyways. It's nearly impossible to perfectly, impersonate someone. But the ability to do it at least adequately and capture the essence of the character. Again, that word essence is so important, and that was a direction word that they gave me that really, really helped me fit into this world, fit into this character. You know, discovering what makes that character click is, to me, what helps me with the voice 10 times more. The voice comes after that.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, like, you know, I've been playing Duel Links myself and been a fan of it and Yu-Gi-Oh! As a whole for, like, many years now. And, like, I know from, like, playing it, like, they always try as hard as they can to get the original actors back, like, and they've gotten so many of them back, like, that if they ever have to recast a character, there has to be a reason for it.
Right.
Yeah. So, did the Duel Links crew tell you anything about why Eli wasn't able to reprise the role?
Honestly, not that I can recall. And I didn't really ask. So I felt like that wasn't really my territory. You know, yeah, that's kind of all I can give you. I really don't know. I was happy to step into those very impressive shoes.
And that's fair. I mean, like, it's... I mean, I don't really feel like that kind of information is something, like, they would, like, just give it on a whim, like, you know, probably right. only some of the Yu-Gi-Oh! Crew members, maybe Eli himself would know. It's like...
Right.
Yeah, it's not information that they'd, like, probably, you know, tell everyone or, like... So it's a mystery, that's for sure.
Right, not that I wasn't curious myself, but I figure I would keep my curiosity to myself at that point, you know.
Yeah, that's absolutely fair. So what would you say are the similarities that you see between yourself and Yuma, if any?
Oh my gosh. I'd say the main one is I love how he never gives up. And he's always looking for the most... again, for lack of a better phrase, diplomatic solution, the most compromisable solution. He's looking to make everyone happy. He loves the sport, and he loves the vigor of that. But when it comes down to it, relationships are relationships, friends are friends, people are people. And that's kind of what I really love about him, is the humanity in him, and the fact also that he's ruthless and that he never gives up. He wants to high-five the sky, as they say.
Yeah, absolutely, for sure. What did you enjoy the most about playing Yuma?
Getting back to basics. Really going back to my childhood. Literally the first thing I did when I got the role was break out my old Yu-Gi-Oh cards and look at what I still had. And I just had so much fun doing that. I had so much fun venturing back into my childhood, because that's what a lot of creative people have to do when they're creating something, or when they're blocked, or when they don't know what to create. They have to kind of go back to that childhood place of wonder and discovery. And this, it just came so naturally, because this is what most of my childhood was. So was collecting those cards and trading those cards with my friends, and it was always the coolest kid had the best cards, you know. I'll meet you at the card aisle in Target, right off of aisle 13.
Yeah, that's amazing. And like, I totally get you. Like, if I ever got a role in Yu-Gi-Oh, like, got to voice someone on it, like, I know that's the first thing I would do as well. I would take out as many of my Yu-Gi-Oh cards as possible and just admire them or something.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. It was like looking at my Dark Magician, I nearly cried. Like, just the beautiful foil of it. It's just like, it's so sentimental, and it meant so much to me back then. The fact that it still does now shows why it's still so popular, and shows why shows like ZEXAL and characters like Yuma can live up to the times and can grow with the times. It's just a beautiful thing.
Yeah, absolutely, for sure. So what does it mean to you to be able to take on the role of Yuma and be part of the Yu-Gi-Oh! Franchise through Duel Links?
I think it's pretty evident that it means a lot. It's far and above and beyond what I could have expected for, I mean, even, like, obviously right now, but even if the world wasn't in, or I guess my country, I'm in the U.S., is in the crazy lockdown mode, like, in some places, a lot of places still are, and even through that, being able to, like, Yu-Gi-Oh! Is my, again, what I go to when I'm down in the dumps, or when I'm restless, or like back then when I was sick at school. And, you know, it's just, it's a solace. It's a home base, and it's nice. It was such a wonderful reminder of that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's great. So of course you as we've been talking, you're a really big fan of Yu-Gi-Oh! Yourself.
Oh yeah.
With your recording on Duel Links, were there any characters Yuma would duel against, or cards he used that you were excited to get to record Yuma dialogue for?
I was excited for almost everything, but I was mostly, I think, excited for the Gagaga monsters, like Gagaga Gardener, Gagaga Magician, just because that's really fun to say. And also, like, in the episodes that I watched, they played very prominent roles, and being able to look at that name on a script after I've heard it and seen it seeing the actual thing on a show was surreal. And Utopia number 39, obviously, all of that stuff, any Xyz summoning. And I was mostly excited because I could tell that the fans wanted that stuff really, really bad. And I could see why, you know? So that's it. Yeah, those are the cards that I was super excited to play. And characters, you know, I always love a good duel between Yuma and Shark or Yuma and Kite. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, those are the characters like a lot of ZEXAL fans will be very excited for. I mean, they're like the two biggest ZEXAL characters really in terms of like fan popularity.
Oh yeah, big time.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And like, yeah, I mean, some of Yuma's cards, like the Gagaga ones, they're very wordy.
They are so wordy. And the fact that some, like, these two actual lines that I had were like seven words with like 20 different syllables just was freaking me out. But we got there. It was a process, but we got there.
Yeah, absolutely. And now, of course, that you're the voice of Yuma, if you haven't already, like, you'll need to get as many Yuma cards as you can get.
Exactly. There's a business expense right there.
Yeah, absolutely. Have you started building up your collection of Yuma cards?
Now that you mention that, I literally am going to right now. I'm actually going to open up a tab and buy some on Amazon as we speak.
That's amazing. That's fantastic. So what would you say are your favorite memories from your time working on Duel Links?
Oh gosh. I mean, working with the creative team was fantastic because it was so the opposite of what I heard it would be like. You know, your teachers try to prepare you for the worst and your professors try to give you this not necessarily one track mindset, but this field of view where you can operate in. And this voice acting was not something that I had really considered before. It was basically my favorite memory. I was getting to a point. So I had never voice acted before. And so like professionally, so I didn't really have a professional studio at my disposal, but I had a good quality microphone and a strong PC because I'm a gamer too. I love gaming on PC because who doesn't if they have one? So I have all the equipment, but it was really the creative team teaching me step by step by step. You know, they had an awesome sound engineer who was helping me literally in so many different ways to figure out, like, oh, there's metal ping in the back of this sound. There's a little echo here, so you need to move a blanket this way, or you need to, like, it was a long, long process, but that's my favorite memory because that's the work that kind of gets unsung in projects like this. And it was so fun to just chill with him for, like, an hour and talk about his career and talk about my life while I fiddled with blankets under my loft bed, you know? Like, that's my favorite, is the crew connections that I got to make.
Yeah, absolutely, that's fantastic. And what would you say were the biggest challenges you faced while working on Duel Links?
What I just mentioned. the lack of studio. But it, you know, I made my own, you know, my fort, again, going back to my childhood, my fort making skills really came in handy. I kind of hunkered down and really made myself a pretty effective sound barrier around my little computer chair that I have here. So that was definitely the most difficult thing about it. And the other thing would probably be the sheer amount of lines I had to scream as a 13-year-old. You know, over the time it kind of wears on the voice. So. But other than that, I mean, it was all just fun. You know, when I do this for my job, it's just so much fun.
Yeah, absolutely. And like you mentioned, of course, like the strain on the voice from recording all of those lines as a 13-year-old, like, a lot of like the Duel Links YouTubers and all that do great work, like put together like videos of like the voice lines that all the characters have, like for characters, all the cards, right, and all that. They put these videos together of all of them on YouTube. And like Yuma and Astral have like some of the most dialogue in the game. Like there's like 20 minutes, like,
yeah.
And that's just for like the dub lines. Like the videos with, right, both the dub and the Japanese are like over 40 minutes long, like 20 minutes, right, each way. It's like, it's a lot of dialogue. And like, of course,
a lot.
Yeah. Of course, like from me looking outside in watching the video, like I hear all the lines once, you know, of course, which, you know, is one thing. But like, of course, you have to do like multiple takes on most, if not all, of the lines. So like,
yes,
that is an,
exactly,
even bigger strain.
It is, but you know, that's where the training came in handy. I really can't shout out my training enough. The Conservatory of Theater Arts at Webster University, the voice and speech staff they have there, really, really gave me all the tools I need to stay vocally healthy throughout that. So that was good.
Yeah, that's fantastic. So which would you say has been the most challenging role in your career so far?
Oh boy. That's a good question. As far as like time constraints and like actual executing of the role, I mean, probably Yuma, just because he had, you know, over 500, 600 lines of dialogue. So that was just really difficult in itself. I never had that many lines of dialogue as a character before. But other than that, I mean, I would go back to my musical theater days. We did, at the Duluth Playhouse in my hometown, we did a version of Sweeney Todd, Sweeney Todd School Edition, and I played Sweeney. And that was by far the most difficult because I handled upwards of like 50 props in that show, and nothing makes me more nervous on stage than props because I always feel like I'm going to lose it. I always feel like something's not going to go right. I had to squeegee blood on everybody, but I had to make sure the razors that I had already squeegeed were on the right side and the left side was good. Like, that was a hassle. So maybe that role was the most, and it's a bass and I'm clearly a tenor. So that was also very difficult for me, but that's musical theater. That's another thing.
Well, it was worth it in the end, like, you know,
oh, yeah,
the end result, like, I mean, that's fantastic.
It definitely, I mean, each time you do something, each time you do a role, you learn something, you learn a ton of things about your process as an actor overall, if you're really paying attention, if you keep aware.
Yeah, absolutely. So my final question for you, Noah, do you have any upcoming acting roles or any other projects that you would like to talk about?
Yeah, I have a couple auditions in the works that I can't talk about, unfortunately, but that's okay. I have a movie that I'm shooting in St. Louis come early November called Inside. I'll be posting that social media and everywhere, posting links to that. And you know, in this digital world, it's tough for actors and traditionally stage actors like myself, although I really am trying to jump into the voiceover film world now because I know how well, I knew before, but I know how expansive it is, and I know how different the casting is and how different the environment is. It's just there are a lot of different worlds, and right now I'm only dipping my toe into screen. So I'm in a film called Inside and nothing on stage as we approach, hopefully, what is going to be nearing the end of what has been a crazy pandemic. But hopefully as theater, because theaters will be the last thing to open, but as they reopen, hopefully I'll have auditions lined up and I'll have more things to report. But as of now, one film, Inside, coming out later this year, probably.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that's fantastic. So that's all of my questions for you, Noah, but we also have a question from one of our listeners, if that's okay.
Wonderful. Yeah, absolutely.
So Florence Trask would like to know, how are you able to do such a good voice match to Eli James? I actually didn't even know Eli isn't the one voicing Yuma in Duel Links until just now.
Maybe he is. No, I'm just kidding. He's not. But that's very kind of you. First, Florence, I appreciate it, and I'm glad you're a fan. It was honestly, this. I use this technique called voice soup. which is a technique that I learned from my voice professor, Joanna Battles. She would teach reading people's voices and analyzing people's voices based on tonality, pitch, rhythm, raspiness, breathiness, and energy and overall essence, you know, accent, all of that, all of these things play a factor. And so when I listened to the character, I would analyze, I would just go through my voice soup. I would go through the list and write down like, okay, where is he on the scale of raspiness to breathiness? Where is he on the scale from like for pitch high to low? You know, obviously this character was pretty high on the pitch range. So it's all, for me, it's all in the method, and it always has been. And so that method has proven very, very helpful for me.
Yeah, that's really fascinating. So that's all of the questions for you today, Noah. It's been a pleasure talking to you on the podcast.
Well, it's been a pleasure to be here, Rory. It's been awesome. Thank you for having me. It was great answering your questions. Great questions.
You're welcome. Thank you. And hopefully we can talk again sometime.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'd love to come on whenever.
Great. So I look forward to talking to you again sometime, Noah. Thanks again for joining us today, and take care. Bye.
Thanks. You too, Rory. Bye.
Time to wrap up today's show. Make sure to check out our podcast links. Check out our website, website.everythinggeekpodcast.com/EGP. Check out our Facebook page, www.facebook.com/everythinggeekpodcast. Check out our YouTube channel, www.youtube.com/user/everythinggeekcast. Check us out on Twitter, twitter.com/everythinggeekp. Check us out on Instagram, instagram.com/officialeverythinggeekpodcast. Email us at the following email, everythinggeekpodcast@gmail.com. Check out my Instagram, www.instagram.com/RoryWilliamson. Check out Noah Benjamin on Instagram, www.instagram.com/noah.benjamin.c. And check out Channel 1138, where we broadcast live from, www.channel1138.com. Geeks out, everyone.
I always thought of Kaiba as kind of like a sort of a Batman character anyway, very Bruce Wayne kind of thing. And I liked sort of that Dark Knight vibe that the movie had. Plus, we really didn't stray too much from the original Japanese, which is why also I think...
Yeah, it sounded awesome. It was really good. I know I sound surprised by that, but you know, I'm on the voice recording side. I wouldn't necessarily say that I have Yu-Gi-Oh! Knowledge.